Ladies and gentlemen, in the last issue of Veritas, our headline story concerned the BATF and the Internal Revenue Service. Now, I know that many of the listening audience are not subscribers to Veritas, and shame on you. Tonight, I'm going to deliver that message to you, and I'm going to tell you how to get Veritas, because in every issue, there are articles which can change your life and educate you to the point where you will join us in our efforts to restore this nation, restore the Constitution for the United States of America as the supreme law of the land, restore the Bill of Rights. And believe me, we need all the help we can get. You're going to see in the coming months a more concerted effort to destroy the traditional values of the American people. You're going to hear the word patriot disappear from the vocabulary of most Americans. That word will be so propagandized that most of the sheeple will not want to use it or to refer to themselves as patriots. For just as I wrote in my book, ladies and gentlemen, 5 years ago, patriots will be dubbed terrorists. You're seeing a great shift in that direction now. And patriotism will be considered to be a mental illness. And that's not all. I can tell you right now that the 96 election is over with. It's already finished, ladies and gentlemen. The establishment has decided who's going to be president. I'm not going to tell you tonight, but stay tuned to the hour of the time, because I will tell you who that will be shortly. Just waiting for one little more piece of input. And then I can tell you exactly, just as I told you in the last election, who will be the next president of the United States. Remember, a year before the last election, I told you that it was not guesswork, that I did not consult a psychic. God does not whisper in my ear, although I wish sometimes that he would. I told you that William Clinton, the governor of Arkansas, would definitely, without any doubt, be the next president of the United States. I knew it, ladies and gentlemen. I knew it because the establishment elite, the people who decide these things, told me. This election, if there is an election, has already been decided. And now for tonight's broadcast. Make sure you listen carefully, especially if you are not a subscriber to Veritas. And if you have the last issue of Veritas, listen carefully anyway, because I will interject at times into this broadcast some things that we discovered in our research that were not printed in the article. Our research period covered over 2 years, ladies and gentlemen, and the results of that research is indisputable. According to the Constitution for the United States of America, Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 1, the Congress shall have power to lay and collect taxes, duties, imposts, and excises to pay the debts and provide for the common defense and general welfare of the United States. But all duties, imposts, and excises shall be uniform throughout the United States. The Constitution specifically prohibits a direct tax upon the people and enumerates exactly how a tax must be laid, if, of course, one is. It must be levied against the states, and it is the responsibility of the states to figure out where to get their money. Article 1, Section 9, Paragraph 4 states, no capitation or other direct tax shall be laid unless in proportion to the census or enumeration herein before directed to be taken. Also, ladies and gentlemen, the Constitution grants certain powers to the federal government and prohibits the federal government from exercising certain other powers or infringing upon the rights of the citizens of the several states. It also states specifically that any powers not specifically prohibited to nor granted to the federal government were to be left to the people or to the states. Now, if you've all got a copy of the Constitution, I suggest you look all of those things up and make sure that you understand them. The Constitution states that the federal government's power lies mainly within the states in the power granted to the federal government concerning interstate commerce. Outside of that, ladies and gentlemen, there isn't much power that the federal government has, ever has had, or ever can have within the several states that is granted by the Constitution for the United States of America. Our investigation of the alleged Internal Revenue Service and the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms has disclosed a broad premeditated conspiracy to defraud the citizens of the United States of America. Examination of the United States Code, the Code of Federal Regulations, the statutes at large, congressional record, the Federal Register, and Internal Revenue manuals too numerous to list reveals a crime of such magnitude that words cannot adequately describe the betrayal of the American people. What we uncovered, ladies and gentlemen, has clearly been designed to circumvent the limits of the Constitution for the United States of America and implement the Communist Manifesto within the 50 states. Marx and Engels claimed that in the effort to create a classless society, a graduated income tax could be used as a weapon to destroy the middle class, what they called the bourgeoisie. Magic is the art of illusion, deception, if you will. Those who practice magic are called the Magi, always have been. They have created a web of obfuscation and confusion in the law. When the courts have ruled them unconstitutional or unlawful, they have merely stepped outside jurisdiction and venue. You see, by fooling the people, they continued the crime. These magicians have convinced Americans that we have a status we do not. We are led to believe we must do things that are not required. Through the clever use of language, the government promotes the fraud. The Bureau of Internal Revenue and the alleged Internal Revenue Service were not created by Congress. Regardless of what you have ever been told, they were not created by Congress. These are not organizations or agencies of the Department of the Treasury or even of the federal government. I know this will come as a shock to most of you. And when you learn the whole truth of it, you will be enraged where you have been robbed all your life. You've been paying tribute to a conqueror who has conquered you simply by practicing magic. These agencies appear to be operated through pure trusts administered by the Secretary of the Treasury, the trustee. The settlor of the trusts and the beneficiary or beneficiaries are unknown. According to the law governing trusts, the information does not ever have to be revealed. The organization of the Department of the Treasury can be found in 31 United States Code. That's Title 31, ladies and gentlemen, United States Code, Chapter 3, beginning on page 7. You will not find anywhere listed in Title 31, United States Code, or in Title 31, United States Code, Chapter 3, beginning on page 7, the Bureau of Internal Revenue, the Internal Revenue Service, the Secret Service, are the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. They are not listed. Yet, according to law, all of the agencies, departments, and bureaus of the Department of the Treasury must be listed in Title 31, Section 3. We learned that the Bureau of Internal Revenue, Internal Revenue with small first letters, Internal Revenue Service, all capital letters, the Bureau of Internal Revenue Service, Internal Revenue Service, all small letters, Official Internal Revenue Service, the Federal Alcohol Administration, the Director of the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division, and the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms are all one and the same organization. And we found this to be intentionally obfuscated, both in the law and in every instance of any statement ever given to the public. Our investigation discovered that except for the very few who are engaged in specific activities, the citizens of the 50 states of the United States of America have never been required to file or to pay income taxes. The federal government is engaged in constructive fraud on a massive scale. Americans who have been frightened into filing and paying income taxes have been robbed of their money. Millions of lives have been ruined. Hundreds of thousands of innocent people have been imprisoned on the pretense they violated laws that do not exist over all of the years that this scam has been perpetrated. Some have been driven to suicide. Marriages have been destroyed. Property has been confiscated to pay taxes that were never owed. Without trial, without even having a lien filed. You see, when they tell you that there's a lien against your property, they're lying to you. They file a notice of lien. They have no court order, no judgment, no lien has ever been fired by the Internal Revenue Service in its history. Everyone is afraid of them, so they buckle under, and lives are destroyed. It all started, ladies and gentlemen, during the Civil War when Abraham Lincoln imposed a war tax upon the citizens. The war tax lawfully applied only to those citizens who resided within the Federal District of Columbia and the federally owned territories, dockyards, naval bases, or forts, and those who were considered to be in rebellion against the Union. Many citizens of the several states, thinking that they had to pay, in fact volunteered and did pay. After the war, the tax was repealed. This left the impression with the people that the President and Congress could levy an unapportioned direct tax upon the citizens of the several states, when in fact no such tax had ever been imposed. The tax was not fraud, as nothing was done to deceive the people. Those who were deceived, in fact, deceived themselves. In the last century, the United States acquired by conquest the territory of the Philippine Islands, Guam, and Puerto Rico. The Philippine Customs Administrative Act was passed by the Philippine Commission during the period from September 1, 1900 to August 31, 1902, to regulate trade with foreign countries and create revenue in the form of duties, imposts, and excises. This act created the federal government's first trust fund called Trust Fund No. 1, the Philippine Special Fund Customs Duties. Title 31, United States Code, Section 1321. The act was administered under the general supervision and control of the Secretary of Finance and Justice. The Philippine Commission, ladies and gentlemen, passed another act known as the Internal Revenue Law of 1904. This act created the Bureau of Internal Revenue and the federal government's second trust fund called Trust Fund No. 2. The Philippine Special Fund, Internal Revenue, spelled in small letters, lowercase. 31 United States Code, Section 1321. In the Act, Article 1, Section 2, we find, quote, "There shall be established a Bureau of Internal Revenue, the chief officer of which bureau shall be known as the Collector of Internal Revenue. He shall be appointed by the civil governor with the advice and consent of the Philippine Commission and shall receive a salary at the rate of 8,000 pesos per annum. The Bureau of Internal Revenue shall belong to the Department of Finance and Justice." End quote. And in Section 3 we find, quote, "The Collector of Internal Revenue, under the direction of the Secretary of Finance and Justice, shall have general superintendence of the assessment and collection of all taxes and excises imposed by this act or by any act amendatory thereof, and shall perform such other duties as may be required by law." It is clear, ladies and gentlemen, that the Customs Administrative Act was to fall within the jurisdiction of the Bureau of Internal Revenue, which bureau was to be responsible for all taxes and excises imposed by the act, which clearly included import and export excise taxes. This effectively merged customs and internal revenue in the Philippines. When Prohibition was ratified in 1919 with the 18th Amendment, the government created federal bureaucracies to enforce the outlaw of alcohol. As protest and resistance to Prohibition increased, so did new federal laws and the number of bureaucrats hired to enforce them. And after much bloodshed and public anger, Prohibition was repealed with the 21st Amendment, which was ratified in 1933, a key date which we have discussed many times on this broadcast. It is the actual year that the United States, for all intents and purposes, died and became an oligarchy. In 1933, President Roosevelt declared a banking emergency. The Congress gave the President literal dictatorial powers under the War Powers Act of 1917. Congress used the economic emergency as the excuse to give blanket approval to any and all presidential executive orders, past, present, or future. Roosevelt, with a little help from his socialist friends, was prolific in his production of new legislation and executive orders. In 1935, the Public Administration Clearinghouse wrote and Roosevelt introduced the Federal Alcohol Act. Almost every piece of legislation introduced in Congress and in the several states since that date have come from the Public Administration Clearinghouse, which literally is under the thumb of the International Monetary Fund, which today is administered by the United Nations. So now we have the Federal Alcohol Act. Congress passed it into law. The act established the Federal Alcohol Administration. But that same year, the Supreme Court, in a monumental ruling, struck down the act, among many others, on a long list of draconian and New Deal laws. All of them unconstitutional. The Federal Alcohol Administration, however, did not go away. It became involved in other affairs, and was placed, literally, in a sort of standby status, waiting to be used. And at some unknown date, prior to 1940, another Bureau of Internal Revenue was established in Puerto Rico. It became the 62nd Trust Fund that was created and named Trust Fund Number 62, Puerto Rico Special Fund Internal Revenue, uppercase I and uppercase R. Note, ladies and gentlemen, that the Puerto Rico Special Fund has Internal Revenue, capital I and R. The Philippines Special Fund Internal Revenue is in lowercase letters. Now, between 1904 and 1938, the China Trade Act was passed to deal with opium, cocaine, and citric wines shipped out of China. And it appears to have been administered in the Philippines by the Bureau of Internal Revenue. We studied a copy of the Code of Federal Regulations of the United States of America in force June 1, 1938, Title 26, Internal Revenue, Chapter 1, Parts 1 through 137. On page 65, it makes reference to the China Trade Act, where we find the first use of such terms as income, credits, withholding, assessment and collection of deficiencies, extension of time for payment, and failure to file return. The entire substance of Title 26 deals with foreign individuals, foreign corporations, foreign insurance corporations, foreign ships, income from sources within the possessions of the United States, not states, citizens of the United States, and domestic corporations deriving income from sources within a possession of the United States and the China Trade Act corporations. A domestic corporation, according to federal law, is a corporation residing within the District of Columbia, Guam, Puerto Rico, at that time the Philippines, the Northern Marianas Trust Territory, and other territories belonging to the United States government, not states. All of the taxes covered by these laws concerned the imposts, excise taxes, and duties to be collected by the Bureau of Internal Revenue for such items as narcotics, alcohol, tobacco, and firearms. The only Bureau of Internal Revenue in existence at that time was the Bureau of Internal Revenue in the Philippines and in Puerto Rico. The alleged Internal Revenue Service likes to make a big do, ladies and gentlemen, about the fact that Al Capone was jailed for tax evasion. The Internal Revenue Service will not tell you the truth that the tax Capone evaded was not income tax as we know it or as you think of it, but the tax due on the income from the alcohol which he had illegally imported from Canada. He did not pay the duties, imposts, and excise taxes on this alcohol. His partner was a man named Bronfman, who now owns Seagram, who made a deal with the United States government, paid a couple of million dollars, and got off scot-free. If Al Capone had paid the tax, he would not have been convicted. He would not have gone to prison. The Internal Revenue Act of 1939 was clearly concerned with all taxes, imposts, excises, and duties collected on trade between the possessions and territories of the United States and foreign individuals, foreign corporations, or foreign governments. The income tax laws have always applied only to the Philippines, Puerto Rico, District of Columbia, Virgin Islands, Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, territories, and insular possessions. Under the Reorganization Plan No. 3 of 1940, which appears at 5 United States Code Service, Section 903, the Federal Alcohol Administration and offices of members and administrator thereof were abolished and their functions directed to be administered under direction and supervision of Secretary of Treasury through Bureau of Internal Revenue. Notice it says it was not assigned to the Treasury Department. You see, most sheeple would read this and believe that this was just a transfer. But it is not true. Under the reorganization plan number 3 of 1940, which appears at 5 United States Code Service, section 903, the Federal Alcohol Administration and offices of members and administrator thereof were abolished, and their functions directed to be administered under direction and supervision of Secretary of Treasury through Bureau of Internal Revenue. Remember, there were only two bureaus of Internal Revenue. We found this history in all of the older editions of 27 United States Code Service, section 201. It has been removed from current editions. This is why we encourage the listening audience to find the oldest books that they can find when researching the law or the history of this country. Only two bureaus of Internal Revenue have ever existed, one in the Philippines and another in Puerto Rico. Events that have transpired tell us that the Federal Alcohol Administration was absorbed by the Puerto Rico Trust Fund number 62, Internal Revenue. World War II, ladies and gentlemen, for those who already, for many years, had been applying their plan to destroy this nation, was a golden opportunity. Americans were willing to sacrifice almost anything if they thought that sacrifice would win the war. They would never question the government, for it was unpatriotic, and to be unpatriotic during a world war was something that no one wanted to be. In that atmosphere, Congress passed the Victory Tax Act. It mandated an income tax for the years 1943 and 1944 to be filed and paid in the years 1944 and 1945. The Victory Tax Act automatically expired at the end of 1944. The federal government, with the clever use of language, created the myth that the tax was applicable to all Americans. Because of their desire to win the war, Americans filed and paid the tax. Because of ignorance of the law, Americans filed and paid the tax. The government promoted this fraud and even threatened those who objected. Americans forgot that the law expired in 2 years. It's in the books, folks. Anyone can find it. When the date had come and gone, they continued to keep records, they continued to file, and they continued to pay the tax. Bah! The federal government continued to print returns and collect the tax, knowing full well that the law had expired. Never mind the fact that no citizen of any of the several states of the Union was ever liable to pay the tax in the first place. The fiction that because it was an excise tax, it was legal, is not true, ladies and gentlemen. The power of the federal government is limited to its own property, as stated in Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 17, and to regulate commerce with foreign nations and among the several states and with the Indian tribes, as stated in Article 1, Section 8, Paragraph 3, 18 United States Code, Section 921, Definitions, states, quote, "The term interstate or foreign commerce includes commerce between any place in a state and any place outside of that state or within any possession of the United States, not including the canal zone or the District of Columbia, but such term does not include commerce between places within the same state, but through any place outside of that state. The term state includes the District of Columbia, the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, and the possessions of the United States, not including the canal zone," end quote. Only employees of the federal government, residents of the District of Columbia, residents of naval bases, residents of forts, United States citizens of the Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, territories, and insular possessions were lawfully required to file and pay the victory tax.
Reloaded in front of the roll with a finger crossed.
Ladies and gentlemen, Veritas is the only national newspaper that is hand-delivered by special messenger to everybody in Washington, D.C. Every senator, every representative, every agency and department head, every member of the cabinet, the president, and the vice president, at my expense. In only 5 issues, we have reached a subscription base of over 6,000 subscribers. It is important, ladies and gentlemen, that if you are not receiving Veritas, that you subscribe now. The next issue is a killer. It's going to outline the deception that they are using to place United States military forces under command of foreign officers under the flag of the United Nations. It is unconstitutional, illegal, and unlawful. It is, in fact, treason. If you would like to subscribe, send $27 for 24 issues to Veritas. Make your check or money order payable to Veritas. Spelled V as in Victor, E-R-I-T-A-S. Veritas is Latin for truth, and it is the only newspaper in the United States of America today where you're likely to find any truth at all. Send your check or money order for $27 for 24 issues to Post Office Box 3390. That's P.O. Box 3390, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. Again, that's $27 for 24 issues. Make your check or money order payable to Veritas. V as in Victor, E-R-I-T-A-S. And send it to Veritas at P.O. Box 3390, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. And I will repeat that address again at the end of this broadcast. And folks, while you're at it, call Swift America Trading. Thank them for sponsoring the Hour of the Time. Tell them that you're a steady listener to William Cooper and the Hour of the Time, and you'll receive red carpet VIP treatment. Get your hands on some real money. And do it now, because tomorrow night you're going to hear that it is, in fact, already decided and already being implemented. We are going to a cashless society, and we have it straight from the horse's mouth. The number to call to get your hands on some real money and not get caught with your pants down is 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. 2646. And also, ladies and gentlemen, the intelligence service of the Second Continental Army of the Republic is looking for a few good men and women. I sped it up there so that we could get on with this. In 1953, the United States relinquished its control over the Philippines. Why do the Philippine Pure Trusts, number one, customs and duties, and number two, internal revenue, continue to be administered today? In 1953, we relinquished all control over the Philippines, yet the trusts are still in existence. They are still being administered. Customs and duties and internal revenue are still in existence, yet we are not in the Philippines. Who are the settlers of these trusts? What is done with the funds in these trusts? What businesses, if any, do these trusts operate? Who are the beneficiaries? Now, you should all know by now that every agency of the United States government has franking privileges. If you get a letter from any legitimate agency of the United States government, it doesn't require a stamp or to be stamped. Yet every time you get a letter from the Internal Revenue Service, it is stamped and postage has been paid. That is because, ladies and gentlemen, it is not an agency or a branch of any portion of the federal government or the government of any of the several states. Who are the beneficiaries of these trusts? Coincidentally, on July 9th, 1953, the Secretary of the Treasury, G.M. Humphrey, citing, and I quote, "by virtue of the authority vested in me," end quote. Let me say that again. Citing, "by virtue of the authority vested in me," changed the name of the Bureau of the Internal Revenue, BIR, to Internal Revenue Service when he signed what is now Treasury Order 150-06. This was an obvious attempt to legitimize the Bureau of Internal Revenue. Without the approval of Congress or the President, Humphrey, without any legal authority, tried to turn a pure trust into an agency of the Department of the Treasury. Yet, in the United States Code, it is still to this day not listed as an agency of the Department of the Treasury. But people bought it. His actions were illegal, but went unchallenged. Did he change the name of the BIR in Puerto Rico or the BIR in the Philippines? In 1954, the United States picked up Guam under the Mutual Security Act. The Act and other documents make reference to the definition of Guam and the United States as being mutually interchangeable. In the same year, the Internal Revenue Code of 1954 was passed. The code provides for the United States and Guam to coordinate the individual income tax. Pertinent information on the tax issue may be found in 26 Code of Federal Regulations 301.7654-1, called Coordination of United States and Guam Individual Income Taxes, 26 CFR 7654-1 small e, Military Personnel in Guam, 48 United States Code, section 1421 small I, Income Tax Laws Defined. The Constitution forbids unapportioned direct taxes upon the citizens of the several states of the 50 states of the Union. Therefore, the federal government must trick or defraud people into volunteering to pay taxes as, quote, U period S period citizens of either Guam, the Virgin Islands, or Puerto Rico. It sounds absolutely insane, and it is, ladies and gentlemen, but it is absolutely true. Don't you feel great? B.T. Barnum said there's a sucker born every minute, and in the United States, he was wrong. There's about 18 suckers born every half a second. On June 6, 1972, Acting Secretary of the Treasury, Charles E. Walker, signed Treasury Order No. 120-01, which established the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Now, he did this with the stroke of his pen, citing again, "by virtue of the authority vested in me as Secretary of the Treasury," without any legislation passed from Congress, without any executive order or approval of the President or the American people or any knowledge of any of those people that he was even doing this. "By virtue of the authority vested in me as Secretary of the Treasury," including the authority in Reorganization Plan No. 26 of 1950. He ordered the transfer, as specified herein, the functions, powers, and duties of the Internal Revenue Service arising under laws relating to alcohol, tobacco, firearms, and explosives, including the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division of the Internal Revenue Service, to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, hereinafter referred to as the Bureau, which is hereby established. The Bureau shall be headed by the Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, hereinafter referred to as the Director. The Director shall perform his duties under the general direction of the Secretary of the Treasury, hereinafter referred to as the Secretary, and under the supervision of the Assistant Secretary, Enforcement, Tariff, and Trade Affairs and Operations, hereinafter referred to as the Assistant Secretary. Did you know, ladies and gentlemen, that in Puerto Rico there is a Secretary of the Treasury? Did you know that in the Philippines, during the days that we had possession of the Philippines, there was a Secretary of the Treasury? Treasury Order 120-01 assigned to the new Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, Chapters 51, 52, and 53 of the Internal Revenue Code of 1954, and Sections 7652 and 7653 of such code, Chapters 61 through 80, inclusive of the Internal Revenue Code of 1954, the Federal Alcohol Administration Act, 27 U.S.C. Chapter 8, which in 1935 the Supreme Court had declared unconstitutional within the several states of the Union, 18 United States Code, Chapter 44, Title 7, Omnibus Crime Control and Safe Streets Act of 1968, 18 United States Code, Appendix, Sections 1201 to 1203, 18 United States Code, 1262 to 1265, 1952, and 3615, and etc. Mr. Walker then makes a statement within Treasury Order 120-01 that is very revealing. And he says this, quote, "The terms Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division, and Commissioner of Internal Revenue were ever used in regulations, rules, and instructions and forms issued or adopted for the administration and enforcement of the laws specified in paragraph 2 hereof, which are in effect or in use on the effective date of this order, shall be held to mean the Director." Who is the Director? Well, he's already specified it in this order. He says the Director is the Director of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. You see, Walker seemed to branch the Internal Revenue Service, IRS, creating the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, BATF, and then, with that last statement, joined them back together into one. Incredible, isn't it? In the Federal Register, Volume 41, Number 180 of Wednesday, September 15th, 1976, we find this, quote, "The term Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division has been replaced by the term Internal Revenue Service." End quote. We found this pattern of deception and obfuscation everywhere we looked during our investigation. For further evidence of the fact that the Internal Revenue Service and the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms are one and the same organization, check 27 U.S.C.A. Section 201. This is how the Magi perform magic. Secretary Humphrey, with no authority, creates an agency of the Department of the Treasury called Internal Revenue Service, out of the air, from an offshore pure trust called Bureau of Internal Revenue. The settlor and beneficiaries of the trust are unknown. The trustee is the Secretary of the Treasury. Acting Secretary Walker further launders the trust by creating from the alleged Internal Revenue Service the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Unlike Humphrey, however, Walker assuaged himself of any guilt when he nullified the order by proclaiming, and I quote, the terms Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division and Commissioner of Internal Revenue were ever used in regulations, rules, and instructions and forms issued or adopted for the administration and enforcement of the laws specified in paragraph 2 hereof, which are in effect or in use on the effective date of this order, shall be held to mean the Director. In the order, the Director as defined as the Director of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Walker created the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms from the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division of Humphrey's Internal Revenue Service. He then says that what was transferred is the same entity as the Commissioner of Internal Revenue. He knew he could not legally create something from nothing without the authority of Congress and or the President, so he made it look like he did something that he had, in fact, not done. To compound the fraud, the Federal Register published the unbelievable assertion that a person had been replaced with a thing. The term Director of the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division has been replaced with the term Internal Revenue Service. The Internal Revenue Service, in all actuality, under this Treasury order, is one single person. The Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division. The Federal Alcohol Administration, which administered the Federal Alcohol Act, and offices of members and administrator thereof were abolished, and their functions were directed to be administered under direction and supervision of the Secretary of Treasury through Bureau of Internal Revenue, now Internal Revenue Service. The Federal Alcohol Act was ruled unconstitutional within the 50 states, so was transferred to the Bureau of Internal Revenue, which is an offshore trust, which became the Internal Revenue Service, which gave birth to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, and somehow the term Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division, which is a person within the BATF, spawned the alleged Internal Revenue Service via another flick of the pen on September 15, 1976. In a brilliant flash of logic, our research team, a portion of which was headed by Wayne C. Benson, determined that he could check these facts by filing a Freedom of Information Act request asking the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms to name the person who now administers the Federal Alcohol Act. If we were wrong, a reply stating that no record exists as to any name of any person who administers the act would be returned. The request was submitted to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. The reply came back on July the 14th, 1994, from the Secret Service, an unexpected source, which discloses a connection we had not suspected. The reply states that John McGaw, of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms of the Department of the Treasury, administers the Federal Alcohol Act, an act which was declared unconstitutional in 1935 by the United States Supreme Court. You may remember from the Waco hearings that John McGaw is the Director, Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Every single bit of our research was confirmed by that one admission. Now, despite, ladies and gentlemen, all the pen flicking and the smoke and mirrors, there is no such organization of the Department of the Treasury known as Internal Revenue Service or the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. Title 31, United States Code, is Money and Finance, and therein are published the laws pertaining to the Department of the Treasury, DOT. Title 31, United States Code, Chapter 3, is a statutory list of the organizations of the Department of the Treasury. Internal Revenue Service and our Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms are not listed anywhere within Title 31, United States Code, as agencies or organizations of the Department of the Treasury. They are referenced, however, as, quote, to be audited, end quote, by the Comptroller General in Title 31 United States Code, Section 713. And indeed, if they are the pure trusts that we know them to be, this is exactly how they should be referenced. Now, we've already demonstrated that both of these organizations are in reality the same organization. Where we find one, we will surely find the other. In 27, Code of Federal Regulations, Chapter 1, Section 250.11, definitions, we find, quote, and listen to this, it is the only definition extent at all for this term, quote, United States Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Office, dash, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Office in Puerto Rico. And we also find this, Secretary, the Secretary of the Treasury of Puerto Rico. And we also find this, Revenue Agent, any duly authorized Commonwealth Internal Revenue Agent of the Department of the Treasury of Puerto Rico. Remember that Internal Revenue is the name of the Puerto Rico Trust number 62 for all of these terms that I have just disclosed to you. Begin with uppercase letters. It is perfectly logical and reasonable that a revenue agent works as an employee for the Department of the Treasury of the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, since there is no such thing in the federal government anywhere within the law. Prove me wrong. Where is the alleged Internal Revenue Service? The Internal Revenue Code of 1939, also known as the Internal Revenue Code of 1954, etc., 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 27 Code of Federal Regulations, refers to Title 26 as relevant to Title 27. As per 27 Code of Federal Regulations, Chapter 1, Section 250.30, which states that 26 United States Code 5001, small a, 1, is governing a 27 United States Code law. In fact, 26 United States Code, Chapters 51, 52, and 53 are the alcohol, tobacco, and firearms taxes administered by the Internal Revenue Service, alias Bureau of Internal Revenue, alias Virgin Islands Bureau of Internal Revenue, alias Director Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division, alias Internal Revenue Service. According to 26 Code of Federal Regulations, Section 1.6001-1, small d, records, listen to this carefully. No one is required to keep records or file returns unless specifically notified by the district director by notice served upon him in writing to make such returns, render such statements, or keep such specific records as will enable the district director to determine whether or not such person is liable for tax under Subtitle A of the Code. 26 Code of Federal Regulations states that this rule includes state individual income taxes. Now don't get yourself all lathered up, because state means, and I quote, the District of Columbia, U.S. Virgin Islands, Guam, Northern Marianas Islands, Puerto Rico, territories, and insular possessions, end quote. 44 United States Code says that every regulation or rule must be published in the Federal Register. It also states that every regulation or rule must be approved by the Secretary of the Treasury. If there is no regulation, there is no implementation of the law. If there is no regulation, there is no implementation of the law. There is no regulation governing, quote, failure to file a return, end quote. If you don't believe me, you look for yourself. There is no computer code for failure to file. The only thing we could find was a requirement stating where to file an income tax return. This can be found in 26 Code of Federal Regulations, Section 1.6091-3, which states that, and I quote, income tax returns are required to be filed with the Director of International Operations, end quote. Now, just who in the hell is the Director of International Operations? No one, ladies and gentlemen, in government is allowed to do anything unless they have been given specific written authority in the law, or someone who has been given authority in the law gives that person a delegation of authority order, spelling out exactly what they can and cannot do under that specific order. We combed the Department of the Treasury's handbook of delegation orders, and we found that no one in the Internal Revenue Service or the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms has any authority whatsoever to do most of the things that they have been doing for years. I will continue this tomorrow night. In the meantime, send your $27, ladies and gentlemen, with your check made out to Veritas, V as in Victor, E-R-I-T-A-S, to Veritas, Post Office Box 3390, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. That's Veritas, Post Office Box 3390. St. John's, Arizona, 85936. For $27, you can get 24 issues of the only newspaper in the United States of America that doesn't feed you full of pablum and bury you in a pile of bullshit. Good night, ladies and gentlemen, and God bless you all.